We have done these two sentences last time, these three, but we'll just quickly see them again. Immortally, she conceived herself in him, in the creature, the unveiled creatrix works. Her face is seen through his face, her eyes through his eyes. Her being is his through a vast identity. Then is revealed in man the overt divine. Ecstatic oneness and dynamic power descend in him. The integral Godhead sees his soul and body take that splendid stamp. Immortally she conceives herself in him. She, well, in the immediate context, it is mother of the world. It is mother of the world. Well, she is not exactly para-prakriti, but the higher power of the divine Shakti, who is operating as the mother of this world, you see. Now, here we have a complete identity of Ashwapati with her. Immortally she conceives herself in him. She herself is now in him presently. In the creature, the unveiled creatrix. Creatrix, again same. She herself was unveiled. Now she is open. She is visible, so to say. Until now, she was working from behind the scene, but now she is kind of visible, overt, unveiled. Her face is seen through his face, her eyes through his eyes. What a powerful kind of a thing. Her face is seen, means if you want to see her face, you look at him and she is there. He looks with her eyes and she looks with his eyes, you see. Such a kind of an identity is already there. Her being is his through a vast identity. So that is the kind of oneness they have already established between the mother of the world and Ashwapati. Now, a question might arise, if there is such a oneness between the two, can they be distinguished? Can they be distinguished? See, they are absolutely one, yet can they are individuals, two separate entities, separate beings. Can they be still identified? Okay, this is Ashwapati. Okay, this is the mother of the worlds. Can one say that still? See. Now, there is a reference in the Veda about Kutsa Angirasa Rishi. He worshipped Indra greatly and he had identified himself completely with Indra. And Indra used to take him in his chariot to heaven. Right, Madam? They were one, Kutsa Angirasa and Indra, they were one. Now, it is also said that it is only Indra's spouse, Sachi, who could distinguish between them. She would know that this is Indra and this is Kutsa. She alone could distinguish between them. Although they were so identical, identified themselves so much, yet she could make a difference between this is Kutsa and this is Indra. See, because her discernment, her perception, the power of understanding which is there is a divine understanding, in her case, divine understanding. And she could make a distinction. How she could make a distinction? That this man belongs to what is called Manomaya Purusha or he belongs to what is called Deva Purusha. In the terminology of Ramakrishna, one belongs to Ishvara Koti and the other belongs to Manushya Koti. Manushya means man. He belongs to the category of man. The other belong to the category of God. Ishvara Koti, God, Ishvara Koti, Manushya Koti. Now, a discernment can come when you have spiritually developed to that extent. Yes, he is a non-evolutionary being. He is an evolutionary being. So there is a difference. Although there is an identity between the two, yet one belongs to Manushya Koti, other belongs to Ishvara Koti. Same thing is here also, you see. She belongs to Ishvara Koti, he belongs to Manushya Koti. So although there is a oneness, there is an identity, the inner quality of their being, they are functionally different. You have divine qualities, everybody has divine qualities, yet you express all the divine qualities with your own distinct individuality. That individuality is still separate. It is a divine separation, but you have to be an individual that way, you see. So that way, immortally she conceives herself in him, in the creature, the unveiled creatrix works. Her face is seen through his face, her eyes through his eyes. Means for a person, immediately say, well, there is no difference between the two at all, you see, with that. Yet, there is that Ishvara Koti and Manushya Koti difference is there between them, you see. Her being is his through a vast identity. In other words, she belongs to the non-evolutionary power. He belongs to the evolutionary category. And therefore, a distinction can be made between them. Well, his being is his through a vast identity. Then is revealed in man, the overt divine. When she and you have identified yourself together, then the real divine comes out in you. Means the condition for the over divine to exist in you, that for you to be like a divine, you have to have first the identity with the divine Shakti. You have to have identity with the divine Shakti. Then is revealed in man, the over divine. When that identity is established, then you have got the most wonderful experience. A static oneness and dynamic power descend in him. A static oneness and dynamic power descend in him. We have talked about this line last time also. The integral Godhead's seal, a static oneness and dynamic power. See, this line has a slight enjambment. A static oneness and dynamic power descend in him. That is how it runs. Still, you will not let the line overflow so much. A static oneness and dynamic power descend in him. You see, I mean, you have a slight pause at the end of the line, you see. The integral Godhead sign. So that oneness is the integral sign of the Godhead seal. His soul and body take that splendid stamp. That is what is put on his, you see. The splendid stamp. Now all this has become possible because of his identity with the creatrix. All this has become possible. So you can't really have such an experience of static oneness and dynamic power unless you have identified yourself completely with the divine Shakti. So when I was telling you last time that the static oneness was shaped into the experience in Baroda, around 1st January 1908. Dynamic power was his experience in the jail around August 1908. Both these experiences are the integral seals of the Godhead. Now these experiences of oneness means automatically, at once, immediately, that he had identified himself completely with the Divine Mother. He could not have had these experiences without that. He could not have had that experience without that, you see. He had already identified himself completely in jail as early as 1908. So now how this happened is most marvelous, you see. In Sri Aurobindo's very early spiritual life, he had that identity with the Divine Shakti. And with that identity with the Divine Shakti, he has got this static oneness and dynamic power in him. It's most amazing, I tell you. I mean, if you translate that thing into life of Sri Aurobindo, I mean, at a very early stage of his spiritual life, beginning of life, spiritual life, he already has that experience. And that experience comes only when he has identified himself completely with the Divine Shakti. The identification of the Divine Shakti is so much already with him that perhaps even the instructor who gave him the experience of static oneness was not aware of. Vishnu Bhaskar Lele, it is said, who sat with him for 3 days and received the experience of silent Brahman. Silent Brahman. Of static oneness, silent Brahman, silent mind, as he calls it, you see, silent mind. Now, perhaps even Vishnu Bhaskar Lele did not see in him that behind this man, behind him, is already that oneness with the Divine Shakti. Well, it is absolutely amazing, I must say that.